Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to worship. As you come in and settle into place this morning, let me tell you that if you came in this morning and somehow managed to not pick up a communion cup, if you would let the ushers know, they will be happy to make sure that you have one of those, so when the time comes, you will be ready to join us in communion. Is there anybody who is without a communion cup this morning? Becky, also up front here, there's one. Anybody else? Anybody else? Put your hand up if you don't have a communion cup. We don't want to miss anyone. All right, thank you, and thank you, Becky and Gary and Jim, for faithfully serving us in the sanctuary or in the foyer. I have a few announcements this morning, and I will try to make them brief. First of all, we are collecting items for the county home residents, and there's a list in the bulletin of what those are, and also on social media, and also on the screen right now. So if you can bring any of those in, there's a table in the foyer, and you can leave them there. And we will get them all gathered up later. Adult Sunday school materials for March, April, May are available. They are on the bookshelves that are in the foyer. If you are interested in a devotional or a Sunday school a Sunday school lesson or the standards, they are there and available, and you're welcome to pick those up. And here we go. It's a busy week. Monday evening, 7 p.m., Guys and God and a Few Marys and Martha are meeting at 7 o'clock at Over the Moon Pizza for a Bible study in the book of John. I think that's going really well. Attendance is going up. Mike Walsh can answer any questions you have about that. And everyone is welcome. Bring a friend if you'd like to and join them. On Tuesday, March the 2nd, I can't believe it's March, but anyway, Tuesday, March the 2nd, the teens will be meeting with Pastor Kevin and Jenna for some pizza and some conversation, some fellowship and some fun at Over the Moon Pizza. So if you're a teen and you'd like to be part of that, join them there. And March the 3rd, that's on Wednesday, it's the second session of a charitable discourse, and there is a mistake in the bulletin. I don't know who did that, but that study is starting at 6:30, not 7. I would blame it on Bob if I could. That's my go-to. Anyway, 6:30, not 7. So 6:30, charitable discussions here in the sanctuary. And if you have a book, please read chapters 3 and 4 and be ready to discuss those. The same time, Candy has planned an incredible evening of spy activities for the children K through 6. So if you have a K through 6 child, you are welcome to bring them Wednesday evening, 6:30, and they will meet over in the Family Life building. And finally, Simply Discipleship, which has been meeting or started meeting on Sunday evenings, is scheduled to meet next Sunday, but that is going to be moved to the 14th. So there will actually be a Simply Discipleship meeting two Sundays in a row, so the 14th and the 21st. So I think that's everything I have, and we are going to get ready to worship as we continue to filter in. Whether you are here or whether you are at home, it is a good day to be with church family and to be in the presence of the Lord.
Thank you, Marilyn. If you would please stand, worship the Lord, all because of Jesus. It is all because of Jesus. Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. We love you, Lord. Maker of heaven and of earth, no one can comprehend your worth. King over all the universe, you be the glory. Amen. I'm alive because I'm alive in you. It's all because, and it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and makes a dead man rise. And it's all because of Jesus I'm alive. Let's sing that again. Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing,
to you be the glory.
Love you.
Maker of heaven and of earth,
No one can comprehend your words. King over all the universe, you be the glory.
I'm alive.
I'm alive because I'm alive in you.
Let's sing it.
And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive. It's all because the blood of Jesus Christ that covers me and makes this dead man rise. And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive.
Every sunrise.
Every sunrise sings your praise. The universe cries out your praise. Singing freedom all my days, as long as I'm alive.
Let's do a little clapping.
And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive.
Let's praise his name.
And it's all because the blood of Jesus Christ.
Let's keep it going.
That covers me and raises death and life. And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive.
It's all because, amen.
And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive.
You are our King.
And it's all because the blood of Jesus Christ,
you died for us.
That covers me and makes this dead man rise. And it's all because of Jesus, I'm alive.
Praise his name. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. We are actually, our very own Brooke here is going to share a testimony real quick because God has been doing some awesome and amazing things. It's okay. In her life. We're going to use this mic. Is that all right? You can even take your mask off so people can hear you.
And you're not having surgery now.
Nope. And I'm walking. And
that's right. Yes. Yeah. So there we go. Thank you, bro. All right. So as long as Amanda's surgery doesn't get delayed for, what, the 18th time, Tom? She's set for Tuesday. Tuesday. It's serious surgery. It involves some vertebrae and there's nerves and I just could not imagine. So we need to be keeping her and their family in your prayers. And Brooke, thank you for sharing. Like that is just, it's so encouraging. And what's interesting is we all go through hard times in different ways. And Brooke, you're 16, 17 now, right? Yeah, that's right. We share a birthday. That's why I'm cool, because I share your birthday. But to see a 17-year-old relying on God like that is just awesome. And really, don't take that for granted, but use it to further God's kingdom. Oh, that's fantastic. I'm just glad to be here together with you today. I'm glad that we're taking communion together. I'm glad to see so many folks here today. We've got a lot of stuff coming up this week, as Mary Ellen said, and then into the weeks to come. We've got planning coming up, and the spring is on its way, and when we have wonderful weather, it rains. And I am just getting used to that right now, but I think that's a good sign for summer. And then if you like morels, that could be a good sign as well. I never thought I'd talk about morels from the pulpit, but they are sponge mushrooms. I'm just excited that just to see nature and creation all around us is alive and that God is breathing fresh air not only into this church but into this community. Folks, get ready, because I know I have some ideas. I know many of our board members have ideas, and we are ready to just reach the community and get excited about it, because discipleship and going and being the church, that's what we really strongly believe in. I just made a video for our district assembly, and that's what I included, because we care about each other, but I feel like this church does a great job taking care of its own when things are wrong. And now we're going to implement that same process into our immediate community right here. Will you pray with me? God, continue to challenge us and show us ways to be you, to reflect you, as James would say, through the refining process to people here in Marietta, even right here off of Mill Creek Road or off of Colgate, Father. Just help us to be your light. Help us to be your salt, Father. God, help us not to forget the folks here in the church, but as we are faithful to those here, Lord, lay it on our hearts, burden us for those who are hurting around us who don't know who you are. God, I pray that you would continue to provide opportunities, that we would be obedient to that, Lord, that you would continue to work on our hearts just as you have Brooks, to show us who you are, how much you care for us, Lord, and that you are literally giving us stories that purely give glory to you so that others may see who you are and how much you love them. God, we give you all the glory and praise, Father. I'm so excited that we're able to take communion together today, Father, and remember what you have done for us and what is to come. Give you all the praise in your name. Amen.
If you would please stand. We will continue to worship the Lord. Send me out.
Salvation and Savior of my soul, send me out through the world to make you known. Jesus, King of every nation, this world's only hope, send me out through the world to make you known.
Amen.
Send me out through the world.
Let's sing it.
Wanna be your hands and feet, wanna be your voice every time I speak, wanna run to the ones in need, in the name of Jesus.
Let's sing it.
Wanna give my life away unto your kingdom's sake, shine a light in the darkest place, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Brokenhearted,
carry to the brokenhearted, mercy you have shown, send me out to the world to make you known. To the ones in need of rescue, lead me, I will go, send me out to the world to make you known.
Amen.
Send me out to the world.
Wanna be your hands and feet, wanna be your voice every time I speak, wanna run to the ones in need, in the name of Jesus.
I wanna give my life away unto your kingdom's sake, shine a light in the darkest place, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Isaiah 6. He said, here am I.
Here am I. I will go. Send me out to make you known. There is hope for every soul. Send me out. Send me out. And here am I. Go, send me out.
is our prayer, Lord, that we want to be there, and as you send us out, that we're available. A song we learned, new for us, and learned it last week, so we're going to sing that song now.
Father, thank you so much for meeting us here today. Thank you, Lord, for offering us a gift of salvation, a gift of hope, a gift of eternal life. But Lord, I know that to be the things you want us to be, we have to make ourselves available. We have to make ourselves available to hear your word. We have to make ourselves available to your Holy Spirit's leading and guiding. And Lord, I think about those words, let every word I be sound like you, and Lord, that's a challenge if we aren't filled with your Spirit, if we aren't listening to your voice. So I pray, Lord, this morning that as you join us, we will be so tender and so open to your guidance and your word and to your Holy Spirit, that the things we sang in these songs, we can really take with us and be to the community that's around us. Lord, there are so many needs in our community. There are needs for food, there are needs for warmth, there are needs for literacy, but Lord, there's a big need for you. So help us to know how we can be that. Help us to know how we can take you to our neighbors and to our friends and to the people we work with. Make it new and fresh to us each day, Heavenly Father, as your mercies are new every morning. Help us to embrace them and then take them out to other people. Let us show the mercy you have shown us to them. Lord, we have people within our church family that have needs, people, Lord, who are struggling with health issues. And think about Shirley Greenlease, Lord, who's recovering from hip surgery, about Amanda, who's facing surgery and all of the ups and downs that have gone with that. I think, Heavenly Father, about Devin Hours and his family and the things that they're going through right now. And I know, Lord, that lots of people in our church family are connected to them. And so, Lord, we pray for them. And I ask you, Lord, to be with Arlene Goodwill, who's also had surgery and is recovering. Lord, we just have a lot of needs. And so we just ask right now that you would bring those people to mind as we go through our day and our week, that we would pray often for them, that we would remember them. And Heavenly Father, most of all, that your presence would be with them and they would know your healing touch, Lord, not just physically, but in every way. Now, Lord, it is exciting to think that today we get to share communion, that we get to sit at your table, that we get to hear your words, and that we get to share in that very special supper. So, Lord, help us as we hear your scripture and as we prepare our hearts to be ready to take communion. And, Lord, as we move on from there into to more teaching from James, I just pray again that you would help us to take it with us. Help us to make it part of who we are and help us to make it part of who we show to others as a representation of you. I pray your blessing on Pastor Kevin, Lord, as he comes to share communion with us and as he comes to share your word. Speak through him, Lord, and to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. It really is. I'm really being truthful when I say I'm excited to finally do communion with you all, because we've had it on the schedule. This is the third time now, and once we elected not to do an in-person Christmas Eve service, and the other time I was sick. And so when this came up, we're actually planning, just so you all know, so you can kind of expect it, is on the fourth Sunday of every month we plan on doing communion. And if you are at home and you want to get the elements ahead of time, I would love for you to join us in that. Communion was given to us by Jesus, right? We all remember. It proclaims his life, his sufferings, his sacrificial death, resurrection, and the hope that he is coming again. The supper is a means of grace in which Jesus is present by the Spirit. It's to be received in reverent appreciation and gratefulness for the work of Jesus Christ. And all those who are truly repentant, forsaking their sins, believing in Christ for salvation, are invited to participate in this. To participate in his death, but also his resurrection. We come to the table that we might be renewed in life and salvation and be made one in spirit together. Will you pray with me? Holy God, we gather today at your table. In the name of your Son, Jesus, who by your Spirit was anointed, Father, to preach good news to the poor and to release the captives, Father, to set liberty, or even to give liberty to those who were oppressed, Father. Jesus healed the sick, he fed the hungry, he ate with sinners, and he established the new covenant for forgiveness of sins. We live in this hope of his coming again together here at Marietta First and in our homes of those who are joining us here at Marietta First today. And we pray this in your name. Amen. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread. And yes, you can struggle with me in peeling the top layer off. He took the bread, he gave thanks, right? And he broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body which I have given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus Christ broken for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life, and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Praise Jesus, right? Do this in remembrance of me. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you, preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and be thankful. And will you join me in praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I love it. I love it. Let me pray real quick. God, as we just prayed your prayer, the prayer you taught us to pray, Lord, may we view you as hallowed, as holy. Father, the fact that you sent your Son, that he gave us something that we can do collectively to remember what he did and what is to come, Father, is just a blessing in itself, and it's humbling. God, we ask that you would humble us today, that we would say yes through submission, Father, and that we would reflect even all day and this week on what your Son did for us. And we pray all this in your name. Amen. If you have your Bibles, please turn to James 4. We are wrapping up James 4. We're getting there, folks. We are working our way through James. Have you noticed he keeps like repeating themes over and over again? And it was almost like he was talking to some stubborn people, like they were Christians or something. Have you ever told your child, please don't do this? And the very next day, they do the same thing. And the next day, you say, please don't do this. And the next day, they do the same thing. And then you yell at them, don't do this! And the next day, they do the same thing. This is who James was talking to. Only he's talking about us. James 4, 11 through 17 says, don't speak evil against each other, dear brothers and sisters. If you criticize and judge each other, then you are criticizing and judging God's law. But your job is to obey the law. I'm sorry, to obey the law, not to judge whether it applies to you. God alone who gave the law is the judge, and he alone has the power to save or to destroy. So what right do you have to judge your neighbor? Look here, you who say today or tomorrow we're going to a certain town and we'll stay there a year. We'll do business there. We'll make a profit. How do you know that your life will be like tomorrow? What your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog, which we all saw this morning if you were anywhere near the river. It's here a little while, then it's gone. What you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, or if the Lord wills, right, we will live and do this or that. Otherwise, you're boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. Remember, it is to sin to know what you ought to do and then not do it. God, we thank you for your word once again, and I know we've prayed a lot, Lord, but I just pray that your message would come through this morning. Challenge us, Father. Challenge us, Lord. Cut through to our hearts, Father. We pray this in your name. Amen. As I look back, I realize more and more how I used to judge people. Whether I was an 8-year-old, brand new Christian, a 17-year-old high school student, or a 26-year-old first-time father. And as the Holy Spirit continues, even to this day, to chisel away at the judgmental things in my life, there are still more ways that I struggle with judgment. Even to this day, like I said, I struggle because I make assumptions based on past experiences. I come up with my own narrative about lives of individuals that support my, well, I guess my personal conclusions as to why they are who they are or are dealing with whatever issues they have. The problem is, oftentimes within our judgments, there is some truth to it. So we cling to that truth, but what we do is we fill in all the cracks with our own opinions. And sometimes those cracks become large voids. In James 4, 11 and 12, he lays it out so simple that anyone who he was talking to then, including now, can pretty much get what he's saying. He says, don't speak evil against each other. Don't slander against one another, right? Follow, and then he follows it by dear brothers and sisters. So it's not like he's talking to people he loves. He's not just talking to strangers. You wouldn't say dear brothers and sisters. That's not the way he's saying it. He's pleading, dear brothers and sisters. He's specifically talking to believers here, and he's addressing how they're treating each other. Our job as a Christian is to make sure we're choosing to be obedient. Our job is to serve the one who judges, because the one who judges will bring judgment upon every living being there's ever been. And that's God. God alone has the power to save or to destroy. He never tells us that we as believers hold that power. Yet when we accept the gift of salvation but refuse to allow the Holy Spirit to clothe us with the new nature, we continue to look at others through the judgmental lens of sin. Instead of handing over any power that we think that we possess to the one who holds the power, we choose to keep a little bit in our back pocket. On top of that, we hide it, and we look like we aren't really hoarding anything that isn't ours, okay? But at just the right moment, we pull it out and use it to elevate ourselves to the seat where only God should be. I mean, what's the point of being a judge? A judge has the power to sentence or to acquit, right, with a verdict. But even if someone is sentenced, oftentimes they have the ability to still experience freedom after serving their time. Let me ask you this. Do you have the power to free people from their sin? I don't. No one was ever able to free me from my sin except Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only person who holds the power to free all men and all women from the strongholds of sin. And what's more amazing is this. There aren't any catches. There are no catches. It's free, and it's free for all. All you need to do is believe that he died for your sins, taking upon all sin himself, right? And 3 days later, he rose from the grave, defeating death, so that you and I might choose to accept the new life, this gift of new life that he offers us. All you have to do is believe. That's it. And if you're listening at home or if you're joining me today and you've never done that, and you choose to do so because the Holy Spirit's knocking on your heart, talk to me. Talk to me, because I want to walk with you through this journey. Unless we're on our deathbed, though, you and I both know that salvation is really only the beginning. It's new life breathed into us, but then the Holy Spirit starts his thing, right? He begins to transform us from the inside out. Paul says to work out your salvation. And the Holy Spirit is sanctifying us through and through. He chisels away at the things that aren't of him and replaces them with more of him. He guides us. He speaks to us through his word. He speaks to our hearts. He challenges us to go and make disciples. If you're hearing what I'm saying, then there really isn't anyone here or at home who has the right to become a judge, except the only person who's blameless. And the only person ever who lived on this earth and is still alive today, sitting at the right hand of the Father, right next to the Father, is still working on our behalf. Paul says this in Romans 8:34. He says, "Who then will condemn us? No one. For Christ Jesus died for us and was raised to life for us. And he's sitting in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us." How awesome is that? Jesus is sitting right next to God saying, "He's mine. She's mine. I died for them. They believe. They're your children." See, God is the only judge there is, not us. James is pleading, brothers and sisters, so it's out of love as he uses this term of endearment. Stop judging each other. Stop saying horrible things about each other. You don't own the right to do so. So, if you'll join me, let's get off our high horses and love our neighbors instead of judging them. If you choose to love your neighbor, then you're sitting in this humble seat that God has prepared for you. But if you're choosing to judge your neighbor, then you're elevating yourself above God's law. And who fulfilled God's law? Jesus Christ. So when we judge others, when we put ourselves in God's seat, then we're elevating ourselves above the blameless one. That is literally the epitome of pride. If you walk away today and still don't realize how much God hates pride, then listen, you have missed something from this teaching series, because James emphasizes this over and over again. Please, please, please practice humility and stay humble. And a lot of times this is daily confession. This is daily prayers in the morning saying, Lord, guide me today. Just submit to him, because there isn't any room for pride when you're serving the Lord. Verses 13 through 17 say this. Look here, you who say, today or tomorrow, we're going to a certain town and we'll stay there a year. We'll do business there, make a profit. How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, then it's gone. What you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we'll live and do this or that. Otherwise, you're boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. Remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do and then not do it. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read this for the first time, actually, probably the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, right? Throughout the years, I thought to myself, wow, James is getting a little crazy here. Because that really doesn't sound that bad, though, right? I mean, I can't even begin to tell you how many interviews, whether I was a teacher or whether I was in college and it was a summer job, or assessment events that I have been a part of, even in ministry, where they've asked, where do you see yourself in 5 years? I mean, right? Because they want you to have that plan. Early on, I used to come up with some sort of an answer like, well, you know, and it was whatever they wanted to hear normally. I mean, honestly, if I'm just being honest. But I'll admit, the older I become, the more mature my walk has become with the Lord. My answer has turned into this: hopefully doing whatever, wherever the Lord wants me and my family to be. Some would say that's a cop-out answer, it's a church answer, but James is saying the same thing, only with a little bit more of an intense tone. But we all know people with dreams, right? Have you ever watched any type of talent show or a music show or sporting event, and they have those side stories, right? You've heard the stories of how these folks have been singing or practicing or whatever it is for the last 15, 20 years, and this was their goal, this was their dream. They knew that this is where they were headed. Or how about a young couple who gets married, or maybe just an individual who just graduated college, and they say this, well, I'm going to travel the world for a year or so. We wouldn't necessarily take that as an arrogant statement. If anything, many of us would wish them luck and say, huh, I wish I'd made that choice when I was younger, because I certainly can't do it now. But James would respond, listen, how arrogant. And with that response, he may even seem a little holier than thou to us, right? But listen to what he's saying. James is saying this: if you approach all of your dreams and ambitions with humility and with the attitude that says, if the Lord wants us to or wants me to do this, then that's what we're going to do. See, there's one major difference, and the difference is this: we're giving complete control to God. We're looking for his guidance and lead. James is saying, your life is like the morning fog, okay? It sticks around for a little bit, but then it's gone. It's like the river this morning. I'm sure when we go home, there probably won't be any more fog. Or even when you take that shower and you forget to turn on the bathroom fan and your mirrors are just fogged up and you're frustrated because you can't see what you're doing. And before you know it, you're done brushing your teeth or whatever and the mirrors are fine. They're easily forgotten. So how important is it that when we include his desires, or how important is it that we include his desires in the big decisions that we make, even the little ones? See, James is saying, if we serve a God who is sovereign, and that's such a key word, don't take his sovereignty away from him. Don't place yourself in his seat. Instead, rely on him. That's what he's asking. That's what he wants. Seek him for guidance, because he wants to show you where to go, what to do. And see, then all your desires become fulfilled anyways, because your desires become whose? His desires. In no way is James saying that we can't pursue our dreams. So please, if you're sitting here going like, I've been living my life wrong the whole time, you may not have been. It's good to have dreams. It's good to have goals. But he's saying, run it by the Lord. If you're a follower of Jesus, take it to him. Leave it in his lap, sorry, and allow him to either affirm and inspire or to even shift where you're at and take you in a different direction. See, it brings us as believers into a humble mindset. God, am I in your will? God, is this decision pleasing you? In the last verse, James says, look, if you know what's right, if you know that God has called you to serve him, yet you choose to shut him out because you have other plans, then you're what? You're sinning. So he's literally saying that if you don't do what you know you're supposed to do, then you're literally drowning in the sin of neglect. See, sin can be giving into temptation. We learned that early on in James, but it can also be resisting God's will and plans for our lives. And this sin is oftentimes easier to fall into because we have strongholds that hold us and pull us away from that. I genuinely love this church, for real. I love all of you. And as I get to know more of you, it's just God affirming to me and my wife that this is where he has called our family to serve. But I'll let you in on a little secret. And no, I haven't gotten any of these, but I did before here. Pastors get calls. I'm just being honest with you. A little behind-the-scenes snippet as they get calls. Starting in the summer of 2018, I began to receive my first calls from a couple of DSs about potential pastoral openings at churches. It was an honor, right? But I know that the Lord wanted me to stay put at New Philly, and so did my wife. In 2019, I received a call about a church and reluctantly agreed to throw my name in the hat. And it was a very long, long process. There were weather delays, several interviews, but Jen and I knew that even though we loved where we were at, God was calling us to continue through this process. Nonetheless, another candidate ended up being asked to fill the position at that church, and to be honest, there was a little bit of relief for both of us, because even though God was pushing us through the process, we still wondered in the back of our minds, God, is this really where you're calling us to go? There were a couple more calls. One of them, once again, we felt we needed to pursue and go through the process, as I received another request from a DS. Then COVID hit. Once again, a very long, long, drawn-out process. As things progressed, Jen and I both had feelings that it probably wasn't it either, but my ego inside was like, am I good enough? I mean, like, certainly I'm good enough. Well, maybe I'm not good enough. Because, see, at that point, I started relying on Kevin. And sure enough, someone else was asked to fill the position. At this point, we were done. School was going to be starting up soon. Basically, Jenna and I had things planned out. We had dreams. We had goals. Once she started working, the answer to any ministry calls would be no. And I certainly wasn't going to pursue anything. And that made Jenna feel much better anyways, because think about it. We almost, honestly, moved twice in about an eight-month period. I mean, we didn't move once, but, you know, there were two potential moves in an eight-month period. So it was really hard on her. It had been an emotional roller coaster for her. It was hard on me. We'd also agreed that the only way we would even entertain a call to ministry was if God was 100% in it, and that if he showed us clear signs, and I mean so clear that our children would see them. Someone would have to contact me, not the other way around. I wasn't going to pursue anything. All these parameters were set, okay? And we were camping at the beach last June. We weren't even expecting anything. If anything, my wife was breathing a sigh of relief. Right? We were headed back from our beach camping trip, which is another story in itself. She convinced me to fly back so she could stay another week, so then I flew back down and then pulled them. Anyways. And on the way back, we actually passed Marietta, and I remember thinking to myself, oh, this seems like a nice place. I think there's a Nazarene church down here. I wonder if God would ever call us to this area. A good friend of mine who's a DS sent me a text the day we got home. And he asked if he could talk to Pastor Trevor about me, because he heard Pastor Trevor had a few churches he was looking to fill. And that's your DS, our DS. This was the beginning of July, and I walked into the house and I told Jenna about the text. I hadn't responded yet to Dave because I wanted to get her feedback. And she looked at me with those eyes, not exciting eyes, but the eyes that say, you've got to be kidding me. But see, unlike the past, because years before we always tried to plan everything out, at this point we decided to let God lead and we just stopped trying to make our own plans. In the end, we agreed that to say yes even to Pastor Trevor didn't mean anything. After all, we wouldn't be reaching out to him. He would have to reach out to us. All he's getting is my name, right? And our prayer was, God, if this is you, which at the time Jenna was hoping that it wasn't. And it's important to know that. That's why I'm throwing these details in. Then we'll hear from Pastor Trevor. Almost a month went by, 3.5 weeks at least. And I hadn't heard anything, so I figured that the Lord wasn't in it, no big deal. I loved the church I was serving in. But I continued to pray that if this is you, Lord, then you're going to have to move pretty quick. And my phone rang. I thought I heard the voice of the Lord for a second. No, I'm just kidding. You're fine. Anyways, my phone rang. And I didn't answer it because I was actually meeting with someone at the time. I didn't have the number on my phone. I figured it was one of those spam calls because we all get them, right? But they left a voicemail. It was Pastor Trevor. I called him back and he said that he had an amazing church, a church that would love my family dearly, that we would feel like they were our family. And he said it was Marietta First. And like I said earlier, what's funny is as we were traveling back, I just saw the Marietta sign. I just thought, oh, okay, that's a nice area. God, I wouldn't mind, you know. Sure enough, we agreed to the interview, and Jenna was actually already working in her classroom at the time because the school year was getting ready to start, and being COVID, the teachers were in school for 2 weeks prior to any students. See, their students have been in 100% this entire school year. And at that time, she didn't want to be any part of the interview. She was done. I mean, and I understand because the past year had really taken a toll on her. She had already taken 2 huge steps in faith saying like, because what you don't understand, and maybe I have told you, some of you, is we were serving in New Philly. My wife was born in New Philadelphia. She had lived in New Philadelphia for 35 years of her life, and her family was there. But then there was Pastor Trevor on the other end saying, would Jenna please sit in on the interview? So I asked her, and she agreed. She hesitated, but she agreed. And then we interviewed, and the rest is history. See, there's more to the story. Jenna had a list of things, almost demands that I never saw happening. Seriously, they were crazy. Between myself and the pastor that I worked under, we said, you can't make these type of demands to the Lord. She goes, oh, yes, I can if he wants me to go somewhere. Like, she'd be like, Lord, if you're calling us somewhere, I don't want to even wait a week on the board to make a decision. Call us somewhere where the board wants us right away. Someone who really just feels like my husband is called to be their pastor. And I told her that this just doesn't happen. A half hour after the interview, your church board had gotten a hold of Pastor Trevor, and he had called me to tell me it was a unanimous decision that they wanted me to come and meet you as a congregation. I was outside with our dog. And I popped in the door, I had tears in my eyes, and I said, is a half hour fast enough? And even when we thought Jenna wouldn't be able to get out of her teaching contract, because trust me, that was a battle in itself, even for us to make it financially, etc., you name it, God continued to provide and open doors, wowing us from the very beginning, and honestly, he still is. He still is doing things. Oh, We've had quite a medical history since we've gotten here. And God has just... Am I right? I mean, just the other... Oh, man, God is good. And all the time. See, there was a time where we had said, even in ministry, in X amount of years, we want to do this. But as we pursued God together, we realized we just couldn't do that anymore. Sure, we could have dreams, we could even pursue those dreams, but they were coded in prayer asking God for his blessing, that if this is what he really wants us to do, if this is where he wants us to be, then he would be clear about it, and that he would prepare our hearts ahead of time. Had we not had an attitude shift even within our marriage, with the understanding that whether it was her teaching or my preaching, when God said go, we were going to go. And if God says stay, even if we want to go, guess what we're going to do? We're going to stay. And this is how we live. Selfishly, I'll tell you this now, we don't want to go anywhere. We love our home, we love this church, and when we say we love our home, we mean not just our house, we love Marietta. We don't want to go anywhere. We're constantly saying, God, please don't move us, because this is like a dream come true. But this can be applied to each and every one of you, no matter what situation you're in, because all of us have to make big decisions about things. And we've made big decisions even for years down the road, but if God isn't in the middle of the decision, or if we aren't actively seeking out his plan and his will in our decisions, then we're basically saying, we got it. We're good enough. God, I know you saved me, but I got it from here. I love you, but God, will you please just butt out? That's literally what you're doing, what we're doing. Imagine how much more fulfilling your life would be and how much more you'd experience his grace, mercy, and love if you included him in all of your long-term and even short-term plans. I, along with James, I'm not trying to say that your 5-year plan, 10-year plan, 15-year plan is wrong, because it may not be. It may be what the Lord would want for you in your life. But what he's saying here is, if it isn't done in humility, in obedience, or out of submission, if you haven't included his input in the decision, then are you truly seeking what he wants? Or is your own ambition and your own wisdom more valuable? And some of you may be sitting here saying, God, am I going to hear, or Kevin, am I going to hear an audible voice from God? Kevin, you're nuts. And I'll tell you, call me nuts, call me crazy. But when you're striving to get to know the Father through his word, through prayer, through wisdom that other believers bring, you'll know his voice. Trust me and trust him too. I'm telling you, he has done things in our lives. And it's not just me, the pastor, but my wife has seen God move in miraculous ways because we've chosen to keep him in the center of our marriage and in the center of our family. Listen, God isn't this magical being in a far-off land waiting for you to die to see him. He actually wants to commune with you on a daily basis. Please stay humble, submit to him daily, stay off the seat of judgment, and just let God be God. Will you pray with me, Father? I thank you for today. God, I thank you for your word. Lord, please help us not to gossip, to judge, to bring slander against one another. Father, to take your place on the throne, God. I ask that you would forgive us as we have probably chosen to do that more than even we realize. God, that when we choose to do so, when we choose to take your place, that you would convict us, God, so that we might become more like you in confessing our wrongdoings. God, I pray that even in the smallest decisions, Lord, that we would be so in tune with your spirit that we would know whether it's you or not, Father. And in those big decisions, that we would actively pursue you, Father, pursue your guidance and pursue what you have planned for us, Father. I just pray for obedience in our lives, Lord. And God, it may rock some of our worlds. It may change some of our 5-year plans. Or Lord, maybe it's just pleasing to know that our 5-year plan is good, is right where you want us, Father, because we have sought your obedience. So God, I pray that you bless those people that have done that. Father, continue to mold us and shape us into you, into your children, Father. Refine us so that we might reflect your love to both believers and non-believers. Forgive us, Lord. We ask all this in your name. Amen. We're going to sing 2 songs here in the end and kind of reflect on your lives in this first one and maybe what God's asking you to do. And then Bob is going to send us off with a good fast one that you can dance out of here to. But other than that, hey, you have a blessed week. Will you stand with us as we sing?
How deep the Father's love. beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, with bruise which mar the chosen one, brings many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held me there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me alive. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? What can be an answer? But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. This I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
I really wasn't going to say anything, but I know we had some folks come up. And so just, you know, even, and like I said, I know we don't want a big crowd up here, but just pray for your fellow believers that are up here being obedient to the Spirit, and pray that God would do what God wants to do. And I know there's probably even some of you in your seats right now that God's really speaking to your hearts. I know he's speaking with me. I think that's why I was struggling to get through some of the words, because I struggle with judgment. I'm just being honest. I think it kind of runs in my family. And so it's one of those everyday battles. God, I need you to give me a humble heart and a loving heart. And so make that your prayer today. Work this week on not judging others, not making, even having these prerequisites against people. And at the same time, include God in your decisions, in everything. And pray for your fellow brothers and sisters where they're just responding to the Spirit. Will you pray with me, God? I just once again thank you for who you are. I thank you for what you're doing, what you've done, Lord. God, I thank you overall for keeping us safe even in this church during this time. Lord, I just pray that you would be God in all of our lives, that there wouldn't be us on the throne, but that we would move aside for you, Lord. God, challenge us this week. Help us go with joyous attitudes, though, and be ready to bring love, joy, peace, and hope to the world. And I pray this in your name. Amen. Join us in this last song.
Yes, every time I speak, wanna run to the ones in need. In the name of Jesus, amen. Wanna give my life away unto your kingdom's sake. Shine a light in the darkest place. In the name of Jesus. Sing it. In the name of Jesus. Brokenhearted, carry to the brokenhearted, mercy you have shown. Send me out to the world to make you known. To the ones in need of rescue, lead me, I will go. Send me out to the world to make you known. Send me out to the world. Wanna run to the ones in the need. In the name of Jesus. Thank you. Wanna give my life away unto your kingdom's sake. Shine a light in the darkest place. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Hope for every soul. Send me out, here am I will go. Send me out to make you know there is hope for every soul. So send me out, wanna be your hands and feet, wanna be your voice every time I speak, wanna run to the ones in me. Give it Jesus. Wanna be your hands and feet. Wanna be your voice every time I speak. Wanna run to the ones in need. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Have a great week. Praise Him.